do this is, I think I'll direct my questions to specific people. I think that will keep things moving a little quickly. I think the first thing I want to start with is, you know, we're here to talk about challenges. We're here to talk about what are the kinds of things that, this community is struggling with. But I want to embed that conversation within a sort of an assessment. Because a lot of times it can just end up just super depressing and just it's all negative. And yes, there's a lot that needs to be contended with, but I also want to get a sense of how are we doing? And so if I could direct that to Sami and to Sheikh Yusuf, if the two of you could take on that question and just as an overview, and we'll get into details after, how are we doing?
Yeah, sure. We're doing great. So I think we are in a crossroad and in a good way. Like I think that there is a lot of I wouldn't even say windows. I'll say doors of opportunities opening up. So as a society and within the Muslim community, particularly, we're having these conversations that we haven't had over the for the past 30 or 40 years. Around inclusion, around opening, around understanding how we have different perspective and different challenges, around celebrating our success. We're no longer questioning. I remember being a young person and you know, one of the reasons that I actually got into community activism is because when I was, being in the mosque community, seeing young women who had to choose between being, gain Islamic knowledge and secular knowledge. So basically, if you went to school and university, that meant maybe you were not the best of Muslims, and if you were in the masjid and you were memorizing your Quran and not really interacting with other people, like kind of isolating yourself, then you were a wonderful Muslim, right? I don't think we're having these conversations anymore. The reason I started Aspire to Lead was, and it was, Aspire to Lead was never about leading others, it was about leading yourself. And it was just simply to showcase that you can have it all as a woman. You can have it all. You can be wonderful in your, you can keep your identity as your cultural and heritage identity, your faith identity, and you can do well in society. You can go to school, you can excel in your, path, whatever path you choose professionally, and you can be an incredible person contributing to society. So I wanted young people to see, and I was looking for these models that were like, and I'm having these conversations like, with young women like Amina, who have like, I'm the generation before you, right? Maybe there's 10 of us that you're like, we're having conversations with you, and we're like, no, go do it. You can make it happen, right? We didn't have that. I didn't have anybody, pushing me. My colleagues didn't have. We were just like relying on each other. Stumbling, finding, falling, getting D's in certain subjects that we could have gotten A's in because we didn't know how. So I think we're doing great, and we've learned to kind of rely on each other's strength and to move forward together. That as a part of a pack, like that we don't have to do this alone.
Yeah, from my perspective, I see there are tremendous challenges in the community. However, I feel that we've grown to a point where we're ready to face any challenge. And what's happening is that, before when things would happen or there would be issues, we would be scratching our heads. But now what we have is we have tremendous leaders, like many of the panelists here as well as in the community, who we know will do a great job because they're not shy about being Canadian, they're not shy about being Muslim, and they're going to say what they need to say and do what they need to do for justice, for community, for the society, for Canada in general. RIS is one of the largest conferences, Muslim conferences, that happens across North America. This is a youth initiative. Majority of the youth that are born here, they put it together, they invite the speakers, they arrange the sponsors, and they put up a great show every December. Similarly, we just heard about Muslim Fest, and there are countless other community-based organizations, no support whatsoever from the government, etc., but we're there. I was just talking earlier with one of the principals of the Islamic schools, former principals of the Islamic schools, about the Canadian Muslim Vote. And this is an organization that mobilizes the community to get involved in civic engagement. And again, this is all youth-based. So things before we would expect the mosque to do, youth are feeling we don't really necessarily need to be in the mosque setting to make a difference. And we don't necessarily need to hide our identity in order to serve. And there are great representatives who are born here or raised here, and they have the strength, they have the energy, they know the laws, they know the different perspectives. So despite the huge challenges, I'm confident that the Muslim community is growing tremendously and they're facing the challenges that are out there.
And feel free to jump in if anybody has something to add. But Amina, I want to direct this to you. This point that you brought up about comfortable in being Canadian and comfortable in being Muslim, that's one thing to say that this is what I'm comfortable with, or to say that I can have this conversation with any of you. Then there's the conversation that, well, it's not even really a conversation, there's the rhetoric that's imposed that these two things are not compatible. We've actually seen the issue of incompatibility of Canadian-ness with Muslim-ness become part of election campaigns at the federal level. We see this happening with various faith communities, but also the Muslim community around the sex ed curriculum provincially. And so there always ends up being this idea that these two identities are fundamentally in opposition to one another. Some of that is just plain old discrimination, but some of that, I think, comes from within us too, where people really are grappling with this. As a young person who is now in this space where Muslim representation is not there, but, you're sort of the inheritor, and I think it's very safe to use this on the panel. So how are you thinking about that? How are you thinking about this idea that you can synthesize these identities all you want, but there is this external perception that these identities are not compatible.
I think that's a really great question, because I've always been of the opinion that my Muslimness makes me a better Canadian. And that's because there are so many characteristics that we learn about when we're children, about like what makes a good Muslim. You have to be a good neighbor, you have to be kind. Giving, you can't be stingy, you have to want for your brother what you want for yourself, and unless you can do that, you can't call yourself a Muslim. There are so many characteristics that I learned, and I suppose that there are two things that come to mind. First of which, I always like to say that I forget that I'm a visible Muslim, because when someone comes up to me, either at City Hall or on the street, and I'm in a space where there isn't a lot of Muslim representation, there's a lot of enthusiasm, like, oh, we never get to see women in hijab. And I look around, I'm like, there's a woman in hijab. But it's me, right? I don't get to see me as I walk down the street. And so I find that very important, because I carry a lot of these characteristics with me, and I try to emulate them, and I remember, the women and the people in my life, or the people in the mosque or the masjid that I look up to on a daily basis, who form the majority of my character. And I claim that these characteristics are what make me a good neighbor, or what make me a good citizen, or what make me good at every job I've ever done. And so I find Vancouver 2010, when the Olympics came here, was a really good time to talk about what it meant to be Canadian, very separate from what it meant to be Muslim, or what it meant to be a woman. And I remember there was like this huge national discussion about what it meant to be Canadian, and did it mean that to be Canadian meant that you weren't American? Did we have an identity that was based in opposition? Could we list all of the things that we were not in order to find out what we were? And there wasn't that. There were, we had like the mittens that maybe the Boca loved. We had this incredible enthusiasm and this openness for other people and other cultures. And when I looked around, I'm super excited, but also like very competitive. And so I love the Winter Olympics because Canada wins a lot. It was a time, I think I was like 16, where I noticed that like to be Canadian meant if you excluded the faith part, the worship of God, the daily prayers, was very similar to what being Muslim looked like to me. In my community, people are kind and people are giving, people are open and they're patient. And that's precisely what I saw within the larger society. Everyone was happy to see people from all over the world come and compete in sports. Everyone was like very excited to be in a position of openness and of giving and to be able to talk about all of the things that they had to impart upon others and to gain from what their experiences were. And to me, those two identities are so intertwined that they are almost identical. I like to say that when I meet like a Canadian who is non-Muslim and me, the only difference is that like I might say that Allah is the one God, and you might not say that. But for the most part, we're the same. And I think that's so important. And I see that amongst my friends as well, because we work in different sectors and we have different aspirations and we work in different ways. But currently I'm working on and do social media for a friend of mine's campaign. She's running in Scarborough Southwest. Her name is Dolly. She's the NDP candidate. And I was in collaboration with another candidate running in the other ward, our neighboring ward, Beatrice East York. And I picked up the phone to go call a fellow collaborator. And it was my friend Noor, who I met at our university, MSA, who we've been friends with for a long time. And we were having this conversation about how like, it hadn't been for the fact that we were Muslim, and it hadn't been for the fact that we both worked in politics at the moment. There are so many things that we have in common, both with each other, but also every non-Muslim person on our team, that creates that form of camaraderie and collaboration. It's the fact that we're all open, we're all willing. And, you know, whenever I run into my cousins who are like from the UK, and we have discussions about who's got it better, obviously yes. it's these characteristics that come to mind. You know, like, what is it that's so great about being Canadian? They say in a British accent. And I say, it's the fact that we're kind, and people say that around the world. What is a Canadian? They're super happy, they apologize for things they didn't do, they're kind and they're patient. And so do Muslims. I mean, like, at the mosque, like, there are women who come up to me and say that they're sorry that they don't have, like, food to give me if I came at the very end of a bake sale. It's entirely my own fault, but I'm like, that's cool, you know? But it's a very Canadian to me, Canadian characteristic to see. And so this, like, this cultural mosaic that we claim to represent, I see very clearly. I believe that I am a part of it. And I think that the two identities, at least for me, inform one another in the best way.
I'm wondering about sort of the question around, I mean, the reason that we're here talking about identity. Does it feel like it's a qualitatively different question than it's been? I mean, I used to be a youth, and now I'm approaching a much older. But when I was a youth, it was a lot of the same kind of thing. And I think it's mirror. I mean, I have Jewish friends, I have Italian friends. I grew up mostly in a Greek immigrant neighborhood. The girls I grew up around had the same kind of things, the same sort of struggles. And in some ways, it feels like this is sort of the Canadian conversation, right? Like, we've always had this conversation about how you become a Canadian, how you learn to integrate, what, you know, what do you bring to the table and what you take away from it. But in a sense, it also feels like this conversation is qualitatively different for this community today than it's been in the past. Is that just me, or how do you think about it? Behind you, want to start?
Well, it's a difficult question, really. I'm just going to sort of build on what you just said. The way I look at it is actually something. This is a question that I think bothers everybody, because and going back to the issue of whether is it really qualitatively different for us today than it was 10 years ago or pre 9/11. It's true, because there are external pressures on us to define who we are and, more importantly, who we are not. And that is part of the problem. And this is why every time there is a terrorist attack and there is supposedly a Muslim or allegedly Muslim name associated with it, you know, we have to, you know, do our share of condemnation, and to the point where, you know, one of my mentors says that, you know, when this happens, it's like, you know, it's, we do this five times a day, kind of like with every prayer, you're condemning. I didn't do it, we didn't do it, I didn't do it, we didn't do it. It's like asking God for forgiveness. So point is that it's become part of Muslim sort of mantra and psyche. And now, going back to the original question, it really made me, you know, much more at comfort when I heard a response by Nahi Nenshi,
who is the mayor, first ever mayor, a Muslim mayor of in Canada, from Calgary, when he was put on spot and he was asked the same question, and he basically he became pretty upset and he said it's a pretty bigoted question, and he said, you know, if you would, the way you have to compare apples to apples or oranges to oranges. Being Canadian and being Muslim and being a father and being a husband and being a whatever, everything else, an employee and a mayor, is all part of my Canadian identity, and you cannot separate one from the other. And it's like one of my mentors used to say and still says, that whenever somebody asks you, are you Canadian first or are you Muslim first? It's a trick question. And the response for Muslims, for us, would be very simple. We are Canadians first, and we are Muslims first. Because we compare it, and just like I'm father first, I'm a husband first, and all of that is first, there's nothing wrong. Why can't you, can all those be priorities for you, whatever those priorities mean to you? And so again, going back to the how we define multiculturalism, especially in Canadian context, and that mosaic that you were just talking about. I think that's how we have to start framing our answers and responses.
Yeah, I just want to build on this. There are internal pressures as well as external pressures which try to define who Muslims are. So the example that was given, whenever there's something perhaps that some Muslim has committed, then what happens is that the media, what happens is that the community, you know, like for example, we just heard about the tragic van attack. Every Muslim was thinking, oh no, I just hope this is not a Muslim.
Yeah.
Right? Again. So what's happening is that there's pressure, there's external pressure that is trying to define who we are. And they're actually, you know, you open the paper, you read the online news, you talk to neighbors, you talk to co-workers who are non-Muslim, they're trying to tell us who a Canadian is and who a Muslim is. But the reality of the matter is we are not defined by what the media thinks who we should be or what anyone thinks we should be. I'm a Canadian, I'm a Muslim, the way I am. If I'm praying five times a day, I'm still a Muslim, I'm still a Canadian. If I'm not praying, I'm still a Muslim, I'm still a Canadian. If I agree with the politics, or I don't agree with the politics, I'm still a Muslim, I'm still Canadian. So we begin to see some of the youth coming up with this type of slogan where, don't tell me who I am, I'll tell you who I am. You know what I mean? So what's happening is that those pressures, either if a person is not strong enough and embedded in their identity, they'll just try to fit in. They'll take off their hijab to try and fit in. They'll try to hide their Islam. Don't call me Muhammad, you'll call me Mo. Right? Don't call me Yusuf, call me Joseph. It's just you're trying to fit in. But you see someone who's been inspired, who's been told, who's been encouraged that, you know what, you define who you are. Don't let anyone define you. They'll say, you know what, yeah, this is my identity. This is who I am. Whether you like it or not, I am Canadian. Right? I am a Muslim. So I think what the Muslim community needs to realize is that let's not let people define us. Let ourselves define who we are.
To follow up on that, and I hope this question doesn't sound hostile. So it's definitely not meant to be hostile. One of the challenges that's ongoing in our community is that our public face is a religious face. Right, we're seen as a religious community, right? And so, Muslims women who don't wear the hijab, or men who may not look like what people think a Muslim looks like, are often quizzed about their religious obligations or their religious affiliation. Like, how come you don't? And being perceived primarily as a religious community has both pros and cons. But I would say that, and I don't think I'm wrong in saying that, most of this community isn't religious. They may be culturally affiliated, they're not mostly mosque attending, and yet the perception is that we are all part of a religious identity. How do you think about that? It's a challenge, and I don't work a job, obviously. I did for a long time, but I don't now. I actually resent the question. I resent it when people ask me why I don't work a job, because my thing is, well, that may be a very public manifestation, but it's a manifestation of a very private thing, and it's none of your business. Mm-hmm. But it's almost as though it's become okay, because we are so much in the public sphere. And so how do you think about that? How do you think about this idea that we have this image as a religious community, but our community itself is not primarily a religious one, even though people choose to call themselves Muslim?
Okay.
It's a short answer.
Yes, yes, totally. A very, very easy question. It's a faith that one chooses to associate themselves with, to be calling yourself a Muslim, right? So I make it very clear, I'm Muslim and I'm Somali. My Somaliness is the food I eat, is the colors I wear, it's the languages I speak, you know, the music I listen to, so there is that part. But my Muslimness is literally my faith, my relationship with the creator, the beliefs I have. It does not necessarily mean my level of religiosity, but it is my belief system. Whether we choose it or not, you're 100% correct in terms of what we value as a Muslim person, and I think it goes back to that conversation that I was, as a 16-year-old, was having with my peers and with my community leaders, who were religious men predominantly, around, you know, going to university versus, you know, doing Islamic, the Quran, not even Islamic studies in the university, but doing Quran memorization in the mosque, and what was valued. So there's definitely, like, and we continued to, I feel like maybe now we're challenging that perspective, and maybe opening up spaces of leadership and opening up the conversation that, you know, you can still be a good Muslim, but not, like, you know, you can still identify as a good Muslim, but might not fit in all the things that are publicly perceived as being a good Muslim, right? Like that faith part is between you and your creator, and what you do is, you know, only Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, only Allah knows, right? So I think we're having more, and young people are very open about having these conversations now. Of what is a Muslim identity? What does a Muslim look like? Right? But I think it's that understanding that we're all on that there's a spectrum, and that there are people are in different places in that spectrum, and people move them back and forth. I was definitely 15 years ago, I think I was much more religious than I am today. Maybe 10 years from now, I'll be more religious than I am today. Like, I don't know where I'm gonna be landing, but our experiences and our, the affiliations and the things that we learn and do shape who we become and what choices we make. So I think it's important to definitely notice that it's a faith association. So we can't say, so if you are identifying yourself, any of us, if we're identifying ourselves as Muslims, then we are identifying ourselves with a belief system, and versus a culture or language or any of those things. So, yeah.
I just want to provide like a sort of MSA perspective, because that's a conversation that we had at the University of Toronto. I was in the MSA for about 4 years. And I still pop in a sort of advisory capacity for a little bit. But regarding, like, so there are two different levels of leadership within the larger MSA. There's thousands of Muslims at the University of Toronto. And in the MSA, there's a small group of executives who kind of run administration stuff. And there are directors who will run magazines or who will run events or have, like, a more outreach capacity. And so there's always a conversation about what the executiveship in the MSA should look like. We represent a religious body of students at the University of Toronto who are at various levels of religiosity, but who come together because there's a sort of camaraderie in our larger culture. What do we look like? Because because there are executives who wear hijab and don't wear hijab. There are men who have beards and don't have beards. And there are also converts or reverts, depending on what word you prefer to use, who are not just white passing, but occasionally white, you know, or are black and wouldn't be immediately identified as a Muslim. So how do you create an identifiable student body? You don't. Our conversations generally include what would an MSA executive sound like? How do they treat them? How do we identify a Muslim by the room, not simply by the kinds of jeans they wear, or their skin, or their burqa, or she's wearing hijab, or she's not wearing hijab? You know, and it's about creating an identity in that way that is so much more than visibility, because at least among the girls in the MSA for the past several years, the discussion has always been that to talk about hijab as the primary identifier of a Muslim woman is probably the easiest and laziest conversation starter you can have. But it is the most ubiquitous, it's the one that is brought up the most, and I understand why. As a woman in hijab, I get that it is a visible marker. But for a woman who is not in hijab, there are so many different facets of being Muslim, and even being a member of the Muslim community, even if you separate the religious part, that we all believe, or at least me and my friends and the other executives and directors had a conversation about, should be more emphasized by the Muslim community. We cannot rely on other people to have these discussions for us and to come and ask us different nuanced questions about what it means to be Muslim if we as well create discussions that begin and end with hijab. You know, she's a Muslim because she has a cloth over her head. Mm-hmm. There are so many different facets to Muslimness that also create that depth and that beauty in the identity and that make it such a large and like culturally cohesive religion that allows for so many different diverse members of different communities to come together under the banner of Islam. It is our responsibility to emphasize those and to talk about those and to encourage young men and young women to embrace those characteristics first, that to be Muslim is, you know, about a journey of the soul before it is a veil over the head. And as soon as we own that dialogue and we begin to have it amongst ourselves and in our own circles, we can then extend that outwards.
Do you feel, given the work that you're doing now, is that a nuance and a breadth that Muslims and non-Muslims are willing to engage with?
From my experience, of course. I mean, I started in the university sphere. I have my hand in several different pots, but what I experienced myself and what my friends and I come to talk about, because we come together actually every Wednesday and we talk about our experiences working within politics and how it feels and how people talk to us. There's a woman at one of the offices that I work at who sat me down actually on my last day. And she was like, so, this hijab, who made you wear it? And I was like, oh, well, me. You know, because the first time I put it on, my mom actually asked me to take it off. And she said, maybe you want to go on a spiritual journey before you become a visible marker. And there are so many girls who share that story, who put it on or who took it off, and who never put it on in the first place just to avoid the conversation, or because they identified long before I did that there was so much more depth to the spirituality of Islam than they might initially realize. So from my experience and with my friends and, you know, the different universities and spaces in which we work, that conversation is ongoing.
Sheikh Yusuf, what about you in terms of the circle that you work in? This idea that Muslim can be a capital M or a small M is not always welcome. How are you thinking about that?
I base this discussion around a statement of the Prophet Muhammad, peace and blessings upon him. He said, God doesn't judge you by the way you appear or what you own. He judges you based on what's in your heart and your actions. So I can't judge. I can't ask a Christian, why aren't you wearing a cross, right? I can't ask a Jew, you know, where's your kippah, right? So there should be no right for any other Canadian or for a Muslim to ask, why aren't you wearing a hijab, right? So, or have a beard. What I see is there are people within the Muslim community that make these judgments, and there are people in the broader community who make these judgments. Hey, you're Muslim? Where's your hijab, right? So, I think what we need to, present to the community, both internally as well as externally, is we don't judge people by what they wear or how many practices they are doing. As you said rightfully, that this is a private practice, and everyone grows at different in different levels of their faith, at different junctions of their lives. And the Prophet Muhammad, he teaches us, peace and blessings upon him, that You know, someone who has no identity of Islam that is apparent could be far better than the one who's in the first row of prayer for 50 years, right? So it's all about your action, it's all about your heart, it's all about doing things that will be productive and creative for your relationship with God. Yes, there are some required rules within the Quran and the teachings of the Prophet, but they can never be forced upon anyone. They can never be, we can never judge a person based on what their practice level is. We leave that up to God.
And so this idea then that Muslim has to mean something. It has to mean something. Like, if you're going to call yourself a Muslim, it has to mean something more than just my mom cooks this food or I wear these clothes on special occasions. And so as a community that's primarily identified as a religious community, and I think that as in a lot of diaspora communities, you end up taking on identities that you didn't necessarily bring with you when you become a minority. And so the one thing that people do tend to coalesce around is religious practice. So I'm wondering where do you see that heading in terms of this conversation around identity? There are a lot of people, the number of people that identify as Muslim is far greater than the people that stand out as Muslim. And so how do we as a community organize that, because leadership often ends up falling on those who are visibly identifiable, while those who are not visibly identifiable will sort of remain in the backdrop because they feel like, well, I'm not a good representative. And there's no single answer, but how are you thinking about how these things, you know, what direction you're going in? Anyone can take that on.
Okay, so I think we should base people's qualities, their skills, for the relevant positions. So if you're talking about internal leadership, is that what you're talking about? If I'm not good at speaking to the media, I shouldn't be appointed as the spokesperson for my organization. You know, I actually mentioned this to the Canadian Council of Imams the other day, that you know, we were invited to make a statement or a prayer, and one of the imams who had a thick accent, who made some mistakes in his statement, etc., I actually said, with some of my other colleagues at the Council of Imams, we should have had a Muslim sister there who is born here, who's in Toronto, make a statement and the prayer on behalf of the Canadian Council of Imams. Why? Because they're fit for that position based on how articulate they are, and because the everyone's watching, we have to look pretty good, right? So just because I'm the imam doesn't mean that I can make all the decisions. If I am not an expert in a certain field, I need to recognize from my community, from my society, whether they're identifiable as a Muslim or not, here's an appropriate person for this particular task. Let's give them the leadership in that particular field, in that area. And that's how we can collaborate and we can move the communities forward and not judge based on simply appearances, right? So there is the struggle sometimes, but I think we're overcoming it. Slowly, slowly, we are overcoming it, and we're beginning to realize that we can't simply have you know, people who look Muslim as those who represent Islam.
So I just want to jump into something since you've already brought it up. You know, for a long time, I think it's fair to say that Muslims in Canada, I mean, there's been a long history, but we're relative newcomers, right? I mean, working on our third generation. And for a long time, our communities were organized in very sort of traditional ways. But that conversation, specifically around gender, is really shifting. And so the kinds of issues that never came up in my youth, and I'm almost 50, so for me, the things that are coming up now, the things I hear young women talk about, and my daughters who are in their 20s, things like, you know, women-only mosques and women-led prayer, the idea of, for a long time, our understanding was that if women of faith wanted to marry a non-Muslim man, he had to convert. But now there's conversations about, well, why is conversion necessary? Things that are actually quite radical in a good way.
for those conversations more broadly. But the formal structures of our community are still fairly traditional. The Council of Imams is exclusively male. And so it's not necessarily about criticizing, but it's about how do we embrace these conversations? How are we, is it essentially going to be, well, there's going to be a group of Muslims that have moved forward in different ways on gender issues, there's going to be traditionalists, there's going to be those labels that we end up with. How do you see this moving forward? And is it important in that way, when we talk about community building, to talk about these things where there's a satisfying answer and there's an unsatisfying answer, and there really isn't an in-between? So maybe we could just sort of, you know, start with you and kind of move down about how are we thinking about these new questions and demands that women are having as the community of women is changing.
Oh, number one.
But number one is the easiest because they all have to follow you.
I'll take that.
I almost don't know how to answer this question. I mean, you talk about the ways in which the community of women in the Muslim community is changing. I can say for myself, I grew up predominantly in a masjid that where the community was predominantly Pakistani. So to be Muslim, I meant to have like a culture that was very similar, to dress in a capacity that was very similar to Pakistani culture. And there was a lot of rebellion between like me and my other friends who recognized that certain things that were being perpetuated as a religion were culture, and not just culture, but a culture that was almost in opposition to my own. And so there were several conversations about it. Some of us moved to different mosques, me included, and we kind of came together a few years later to talk about our shared experiences and to kind of share our traumas, but also what we had learned about ourselves and about what it meant to be a Muslim woman in different capacities and different communities and amongst people who came from cultures. And also at the university, a lot of my friends were converts, and about what it meant for someone. We had a lot of friends who were from like Spain, they were all white. It was really cool because they all came to Islam around the same time, and for the most part, like, their culture was American culture, which for us was like a mixture of pop culture and what we already knew. So they also came into, you know, a room of people who were Somali and Pakistani and Indian and Ugandan, and what it meant to be Muslim in all these different capacities and what was most important for them. But for the group of women, for me and my friends, what we talk about the most part is what are the most important tenets of Islam that we hold on to, and then where there's room for growth, because there always is. You know, like, for the most part, we all say we recognize Allah as our only God. We recognize the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam as our prophet. And after that, there's room for conversation about the ways in which we wear hijab, about what leadership positions we take on and don't. There's always conversation about whether or not we're willing to work in the Muslim community. That's something that comes up all the time. I have friends who've worked for different masjids, I've worked for a mosque before with different Muslim organizations, and about what it means to, just talking to my friends about this yesterday, come into contact with what we like to call Muslim misogyny, and about how that still exists for the most part, and whether or not it is generational. Because we find that there are two levels to Muslim misogyny as we recognize it. There's like the older generation who hold on to like staunchly conservative but also cultural norms that they attribute with Islam. And then there are young guys who, in the age of like social justice warriorism, who are like think woke, you know, in a very Muslim way, and about what that means when you come into contact with it, when people use religion to justify their wrongful actions against women. And for ourselves at least, what we do is we kind of like we take classes together and we ground ourselves in religious knowledge, but at the same time recognize and accept that we all come from different spaces, and that one woman in hijab and one woman who's not in hijab, at least for me, like I have several friends who are not in hijab who I would argue are significantly better Muslims than I am, who are more spiritual, who practice more. There are others who are on a different wavelength, but whose character is better, and so I would argue they're also better than me. And it's about forming an identity of both like womanhood and Islam that is like separate from the hijab, that is separate from visibility, and taking on positions of leadership for which we are capable, qualified, and doing so without apology, and ensuring ourselves that we're going to be there for each other as we do so, that we're going to lean on, you know, our mothers who support us and our fathers who pushed us to be in these positions, and to create a culture moving forward, along with like the people on this panel who are incredibly supportive of us to ensure that the culture that we have moving forward for ourselves and for our children is supportive of women, is open to them doing whatever it is that they want to do, and also ensuring that women in positions of leadership within the Muslim community who are qualified for the positions in which they carry, hijab or non-hijab, are recognized as active members of their community, are recognized as leaders, are recognized as Muslim first and foremost, and to create that space for each other, to hold space for each other.
Wow.
So I'm going to build on what Amina was saying around the idea of culture versus religion or versus faith. So I think it's important to distinguish that. And often religion has been used as a whip to against women and to limit women's opportunities, whether it's educational, leadership, or otherwise. Historically, religion has always been used in that way, so Islam is not different than other religions that have oppressed women, or Muslims for that matter, not Islam. So I think it's important to distinguish between those things and to recognize what practices are Muslim people practice versus Islam as the religion. So whether it's women leading prayers, I come from the Shafi'i school of thought, so in Somalia, women lead women. It was very surprising for me to be in a group of, in a room of 20 women, and none of the women in the room wanted to lead. And I'm like, what do you mean? We're like, why don't we pray in congregation and get more, it's better to pray in congregation instead of us, individually praying. So, having these conversations are very important. And if you grew up in a space where your mother or your grandmother, you've seen your mother or grandmother, build homes and work and do things and not necessarily go back to your father for every single decision in the house, then that, gender relations in the way you grow up is very different than maybe other Muslim households. So when these conversations are happening and there's a blanket conversation around Muslim women's experiences and they are not reflected on my cultural experiences, then I wonder if these are actually Muslim women experiences or if they're cultural experiences of particular, women who happen to be also Muslim. So I think it's important for us to kind of separate those practices. So there are definitely, there are some principles that are non-negotiable in the religion in terms of we might choose not to practice them or not, but we can't change them. These are the tenets, these are the teachings. But also there are interpretations and understandings, and that's where women's scholarship comes into place. Where are the Muslim women scholars in Toronto? Where are they in the Canadian context, right? And who's put forward and where are we investing in women to really learn the religion and to be able to give fatwas and to give understand the fiqh, the Islamic rulings on different things? We don't. And if we don't, then it's always a male perspective and a male's experience that we're talking about. I remember being at the MSA and the brother who's exactly the same age as I was is giving the Friday sermon and is teaching the Islamic studies circle and is sharing his experiences as a young man, growing up and young Muslim women are asking questions in that setting. And this person is more knowledgeable than I am, yet I have to revere to him and ask him. So there are experiences like that happen. How do we move forward? I'll give an example. The program that is part of the Muslim Youth Fellowship, that's one of the programs that I've most recently been part of. And we've been really intentional in having diversity in that group in terms of literally we had these conversations. Do we have women who are not wearing hijab in the program? Yes. How many women do we have in the program? How many black Muslims do we have in the program? What kind of Muslims do we have? Do we have Shias? Do we have Sinaites? Do we have Ahmadis? We have, as an executive team, while we were doing the selection, we've had these conversations. So we were intentional, but who are we putting forward? If we're going to be training the next generations of Muslims, we want the next generations of Muslim leaders to look like the Muslim community,